a diversity of different things, and she's now teaching. I think so. You're on it, but I'm a bigger fan of these microphones anyway. It's a smaller room. We can use it. Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
So we both have been in business, both been in nonprofits, and we've both spent time in academia. She's still doing time. I've been paroled. Between what I did here in entrepreneurship, and which there was a lot of overlap with what I did in this whole wheelock thing that we've been doing for 10 years now, I think it's again and again, I come back to this fundamental question. And so I've learned, if you want to learn something, you want to figure it out, you go to a panel on it, and you listen to the speaker in the audience, and then you come out with the answers that you were looking for. So there's really two threads working here. One is this issue of value and how you really what is how you think about value and all that. But I think the more important point of departure for me is, I'm not a big Bible quoter, but because I can't remember them. But one in particular is short enough. Psalm 4:6, I believe it is. Many are asking, who can show us any good? And if I look around at college campus today, or even I look broader in society, again and again, that just is like almost like a bumper sticker or a subtitle to the movie. Many are showing, who can show us any good? I mean, everybody's kind of asking that question. And yet I'm not sure that people have even been trained enough to think about the answer. I think that's the fundamental problem. So that's why we decided to do this panel. And I think that it's interesting how everybody's doing Ecclesiastes today. It seems to be very popular. But Dave, this is not a conspiracy. He called me a couple of days ago. He said, okay, if I get Christian here today. I said, that's fine. He said, so Ecclesiastes. I said, wait a minute, now that's the Old Testament. But I had done the same thing when I wrote this, and I got a lot of trouble for it because it was long. But this whole thing of secularity and materialism, which is really the framework of Ecclesiastes, that's the world we live in, but we're always kind of trying to look beyond it, you know, looking for that good. And given that we're in a college environment, and we're both spending time thinking about trying to help the next generation along, we think a lot about this issue of how to teach whatever. In this case, I think what we're concerned about is this issue of thinking about what is good, what is value. And there's one, not to steal the punchline for the end of what we want to talk about, because we don't really know what to say. I think this is the wrong question. And I really like to get into one of those where you ask a question thinking, oh, that's what I really want to know about. And then you realize this is the wrong question. And I felt like I learned fairly early, you probably learned the same thing, that in a classroom environment, that I think the verb is wrong when you say, how do I teach such and such, or am I teaching such and such? Because that's really irrelevant. If I'm asking that question, I'm looking in the mirror, what am I doing? The real question is, what are the people learning? So I always try to reframe in my mind, I'm going in today to help people learn something. And I think that's probably the right question, but it's a really hard one. So, brief introduction. If you don't know who I am, which is probably good, I'm Greg Fairbrothers. I was Dartmouth 76. I left here with only one career goal. I wanted to retire quickly and have a farm close to Hanover. So I went into industry for 23 years, which means I didn't meet my goal quickly. But I did meet my goal of the farm. So I retired here in 99 and started a program at Dartmouth, and here at Tuck in Entrepreneurship. That was back when that was a dirty word, and you did that in the privacy of your own home in academia. And I think that has changed over the years, and we really kind of rode that way. So I taught that for a while. In 14, I left here, been doing some healthcare work in telecom, and now running a company in opioid addiction. So that's my story in a nutshell. Rand's story, I want you to tell it, because you do a better job, but you left Dartmouth in 87, correct? And you've kind of been on all sides of it. So what happened when you left here? Just so we know who we're dealing with first. And then, by the way, I'd rather you talk, because we don't have to think of something to say. What happened after 87?
So, thank you. Thank you for your attention here.
I left in '87 and thinking I'd do some career in international. I went right on to graduate school, international degree. And I ended, then spent a year of volunteer work in northern Spain, living with nuns, actually, with the objective really to learn Spanish, because I knew at that point I wanted to do something involved with Latin America. While I was at Dartmouth, I'll just weave my faith right into it. I was born and raised Catholic, typical cradle Catholic, and kind of took it for granted. Things many of you I detect kind of were the same age group, and think culturally things were different back in the 80s. You didn't really have to be as thoughtful about living your faith because the culture tended to support you a bit more. So I kind of waved around, and living with those nuns that year started kind of bringing me back to it a bit. And I was working with a very underserved community. Ended up coming back to the States and went to business school in order to gain skills in order to do something with microcredit or the social sector in Latin America. And ultimately couldn't end up getting a job in that. Ended up on Wall Street for 10 years as an equity analyst, following Latin corporates. So I got to my mission of working with Latin America, but obviously from a financial and a financial perspective. And I loved it. I really did love it. I loved the people I worked with. You know, clearly nothing, it wasn't perfect. But what I did find over the years is it was leaving me empty. And, you know, I thought Dave's talk was fantastic, and it spoke to me a lot, figuring out my way through Ecclesiastes, if you will. For me, what always hit me was Augustine's phrase in his great work, you know, our hearts are restless until they rest in thee. And I think that's true for all of us. And my heart was quite restless despite having what the world told me would make me happy, a great job at being and earning money and doing things that seemed that it should make me happy. And it, as I said, it did to a degree, but it wasn't enough. So I was downtown during 9/11. And after that gave me the impetus to kind of leave that, to say, you know, life's too short. And so in my process of leaving Goldman, I knew I wanted to do something with the social sector in Latin America and in education. For those that know the region, for those that know the developing markets more broadly, the human, in economic terms, the human capital formation or the formation in education of the citizens is really the great challenge, I think, globally. With respect to development. And so I knew it'd be in an education field. Just as a side note, my grandfather and grandmother from my mother's side were immigrants. My grandfather came here as a teenager from northern Germany with neither of them with high school degrees. They weren't privileged to be able to finish school. And the year I graduated from Dartmouth was the year they got their GEDs. They went back in their 80s because they always felt, you know, bad for not having been educated. So it was, for me, I really always appreciated how well I was granted, or, you know, given such an extraordinary education. And it always broke my heart to see so many kids that aren't given that benefit, especially bright kids, and kids that just have something about them. And when they're not given the tools to thrive and flourish, it is heartbreaking. So I ended up founding and creating a not-for-profit organization that worked with education in Latin America. If you'd like, I can drill down later about it. But in a nutshell, we train principals and teachers in a dual-pillar approach, how a kind of a Judeo-Christian values, how to understand your vocation, be a better person in the community, and then very practical technical skills that they can operate immediately, use these skills, and deploy them to be better immediately in their classroom or leaving their schools.
And why did you want that to happen? You were teaching, you're having a teaching, but why?
So one of the three programs is we work with the Rossius Foundation. I came up and spoke with John Rossius a number of years ago, and they immediately, we said, yes, we have to do this. And the reason we chose the Rossius program was because first of all, teaching is taught very poorly, and it tends to be rote learning. It isn't a dynamic endeavor. And second, English has become a minimum requirement globally to participate in the formal economy. And we, as native English speakers, often don't appreciate what an extraordinary advantage we have speaking English on many levels globally. And it's become a new ceiling for people to raise out of poverty if they're not a native English speaker. You go to any job listing in Latin America, and pretty much most of them require English. And if you're poor, it's really hard for you to get that. So I thought, you know, maybe we can use this Ross's method not only to capacitate teachers in a better way broadly, to be better teachers, but more narrowly around the theme of English. So that's, we train public school English teachers. In fact, here, for those of you in the study summer, we bring about 40 really high potential teachers here to the Hanover campus every year. And they subsequently become, a few of them are gifted enough to become future trainers. All are trained in the Ross's method. So we've now trained, goodness, I should know this, thousands of Mexican teachers. I know we've, in terms of how we've calculated how many kids they've taught, it's been, we've now touched over a million kids in Mexico. So that was that, and then the other program, we teach science and math teachers in Brazil how to teach science and math using project-based learning, because the science and math skills, particularly math, are particularly poorly taught in Latin America in particular. And those are obviously skills that are useful to job, to getting a job. And then leadership skills around principles. And so I did that for 11 years and got quite worn out from that, and stepped away 3 years ago, did a self-directed sabbatical in Rome. I was becoming more and more engaged in my faith and decided to study theology in Rome for a semester, and then came back, and I've been teaching for the last 3 years at Catholic University, both on the finance side, so my finance skills, and then some economic development. And the School of Business and Economics at Catholic is oriented around Catholic social doctrine and ethical. They embed or imbue in everything they do. Business can be a force for good, is kind of a motto. And so that's what I'm up to now.
So when you're in the university environment and you look around, what do you see today?
Well, so Catholic is a weird bubble. Mm-hmm. Catholic University is a very conservative campus. And we actually use over 90% of the kids are Catholic and pretty much practicing for the most part. We also, interestingly enough, have about 5% are from Saudi Arabia, so and are practicing Muslims. So and it works. So our kids, I would say, are they're willing to engage in truth. I don't think there's perhaps, I don't want to talk out of line. I don't think there's ideological or, I feel like you can really engage them. You know, I more broadly from what I see, I find students can be more fixed and fearful of engaging different viewpoints. I don't know if we want to go down that track. What I would say is, you know, the whole, you know, Catholic is a jewel to teach in that I can live my faith and I can openly wear it on my sleeve. I mean, I literally start every class with an Our Father. I don't think there are many places you can do that. And so, it's hard for me to speak more broadly, and I don't want to be too critical, but from my experience, Catholic has been good.
So, Vincent, when you look around Dartmouth, what do you see?
I kind of knew that was coming, Greg.
Did you?
Not 90% Catholics, and yeah. I think there's a lot of literature around the overwhelming pervasiveness of the liberal kind of ideology, and what does that mean for trying to build a comprehensive, holistic person when there is a normative perspective that's pervasive in academia? I think Dartmouth is incredibly representative of that framework, that there's one ideology that's accepted, that is sophisticated, that is well informed. If you don't fit within that framework, your perspective is not necessarily welcomed.
Right, it's hard to bring the faith conversation into that. Yeah.
I just love it. If any other students would comment on that too, what their experience has been in that setting. Because any other, I'm just
kidding. Did any come?
I'm the type of person maybe who enjoys having a little bit of I'd be happy to disagree with me, actually. So I just found it kind of fun and like exhilarating, so I've enjoyed Dartmouth because I had felt like an opportunity to have people kind of come at me and say like, no, I think you're wrong. I'm like, well, okay, let's talk about it. And people are pretty smart, in my opinion, like pretty, I've had very like good, respectful discussions with people, like not super hostile. I mean, yes, they disagree, but respectfully so. So I've had a good experience myself.
Lou, what do you think? I have a man back there, he's one of ours.
I would agree that amongst professors, there is this sort of pervasive mentality where for them to sort of respect your opinion, if you're sort of deviating from that liberal norm, I think that there is some truth to that, that they'll respect you, but there is this almost sense in which it's almost like, not barbaric, but uncivilized, I guess. You can read studies where if a faculty learns that a prospective faculty who might join is a Christian, they're much less likely to look favorably upon that application. And I would not be surprised if that rang true at Dartmouth. Amongst the students, there's probably that sort of same mentality, but I would agree with Marissa that there is respect within most of these conversations. But I'd also say that maybe behind that respect, there is a sense of smugness, is what I'd say.
You know, if I could add to that, what I'm hearing is, it was Hillary, and I'll never forget what she told me 2 years ago. She says, you know, I think back in the 90s and early 2000s, there was a much greater level of more than smugness, just looking down on these kind of rubes that believe in these, you know, primitive ideas.
Superstition.
And superstitions, and that's for kind of the less sophisticated folks. And she says, now it's not really that. She goes, it's basically kind of an anthropological reaction that, oh, that's really interesting you believe in that. As if you said, I believe in the Easter Bunny. Like, that's good for you. I'm not going to judge it. So I'm not sure if that's how much better that is, the sense that we've walked away from there any truth, or the sense that all that is legitimate or equally truthful. And that's to me maybe even a harder one to argue or to overcome.
There's a cultural thing here. I spent 23 years, that 23 years was mostly in Oklahoma. And if there's a Bible Belt, that's the buckle. And so there in the university environment, the whole community culture is going to be very different than New England, which I understand is the least churched part of the country today. I think the more fundamental question is, where are people going? Where are the faculty trying to drive a student? When I came here, I think Bill probably could say the same thing. He thinks so. The faculty had a real ethic of, we want you going somewhere. We want you to grow. We want you to learn things. We want to expose you to things. And we have a sense of where we want that to be. And I'm not sure that the whole issue of meaning, value, definition of your spiritual existence is really part of that anymore. I'm not sure if it was back then, because I wasn't looking for it, I'll be honest. If you could be born again, I've been born again and again and again, and it was about 83 before I settled in. So I did not see that here. But the interesting thing about this, to get to speak to the student point, in 2011 we did a survey out of the Apologia and Wheelock Society. We had one of our interns do a survey of the student body on what is their state of spiritual mindset, basically. And we modeled it after a broad survey that USC had done and published around the country. And we took a subset of that, went out to the campus, we actually got permission from the Office for Human Studies, and put up a little table with some cookies and asked people to answer this set of questions. We had no idea what would happen. We didn't know if there would be we'd be laughed at, would be run out of town. We stopped it because we felt an N of 500 in the third day was plenty. It was overwhelming response, and I'm fairly confident it was random, that it wasn't all overly self-selected just because it was so large. There are only 4,000 students registered at Dartmouth. They're not all here at one time. The interesting finding, one was, we could not use the word religion to get a straight answer. But if we used the word spirituality or faith, we did a little better. Spirituality was best. And we defined it,
or we asked people to define it. We did both. And what we found, if we asked people to define themselves on a spectrum of interest or focus in their lives on spiritual matters, between, you know, very much a part of my life, they would describe things like, I think about this daily or weekly, what is my place in the universe, what is the meaning of my life, I pray daily or weekly, I believe in a spiritual, in a supernatural being, I give a creator of the universe, versus, this is all nonsense and superstition, I'm not interested. And we could plot that as a perfectly distributed normal distribution curve. 1/6, very interested, active, pray daily or weekly. 1/6, I'm an atheist, get out of here. 2/3, I'm very interested. I think about these things a lot. In fact, some of the respondents were even taking our questioners aside and wanted to talk about this stuff. And it surprised us in a way. We believed that a normal curve was out there, but we were surprised at what the scale really looked like. And yet they're in an environment where, the second piece of this I left out was, we asked them, what do you think has happened to you over the 4 years you're here? So for the ones who've been here longer, we could get their impression of what longitudinal look like. Where the studies have been done, it looks like this. And they reported the same thing. They said, yes, I think my interest in my spiritual grounding has dropped. I think I'm less confident about what I believe, et cetera, et cetera. And we, you know, and it's normally attributed to the hostility of the university environment. So we convened a couple of focus groups. We wanted to get into that a little bit. So we asked them, why do you think this happened? Why do you think this is true? Is this the community? They said, no, we know that the professors are sometimes looking down their nose at us, but, you know, we don't care about what they think on other things either, so it's not a problem. So it's like, well, what's the problem here? And they said basically what you said. I've come from one background, I've come from one spiritual stance, and I get here with all these bright people, and I'm exposed to all these things, all these different worldviews, and they all look good. And I'm now confused. Some of you even said I'm bitter. And one student said, I'm bitter at my parents for raising me so narrowly in my faith walk. I wish I had known all this was out here. And we, because we're the focus group, we did not argue with them. But I desperately wanted to explore with them the fundamental paradox of this statement, that it all looked good when what they were saying looked good were a collection of mutually exclusive faith truths which had nothing to do with each other. And they did not even appreciate the importance of that paradox. And we came away with the sense that the real problem we were trying to address is that their development of their tools to understand what is good and to choose between what is accurate and what is false is so attenuated that they can't tell good from bad. And so that really is the question I wanted to talk to Luann about today, because she's living in an environment where hopefully they're doing a lot better job of that. How do you help people develop those tools? I personally don't feel I'm in the business of trying to tell people what they should think and believe, but I do think I'm in the business of trying to shape how they see the world and think about what they should believe and choose. Because that's what I feel the higher education environment should do. That's what I feel they did for me. And interestingly enough, these materialists and secularists gave me all the tools that led me inevitably to Christianity, because they taught me how to think and to study. That's all it took. Eventually I even started reading the Bible and studying the Bible like I've been taught to study everything else, and theology and some of the history of faith and all that. Once I did that, I was on a slope I could not climb back up. And that's the question I wonder if we're doing a good job on. So I'm looking for ideas for the rest of this conversation. As you and everybody talk about, do you think that's the right question even? How do we give people the right tools versus do we give them the right information? I mean, I'm happy that people push back on that.
Yeah. No, I think what you said at the very opening of your sentence, which was not what do we teach and give, but how do we make sure that they're learning. So for me, it's more about reflection and self thinking about what's happening inside as much as giving tools to do that. But it has to do with helping them on their journey to figure out where they are and how to get. But more about them. I mean, need to give the tools to do that, but it's with the goal of not being giving them information necessarily, but giving them. Yep.
I got one vote. Yeah.
Well, but you still need some basic literacy, it seems to me.
Yeah.
And that's information, if you will. And you know, I think I'm the geezer in the room here. But in any event, I went to a public high school. Up until my senior year, we began the day with the Lord's Prayer and her reading from the King James Bible, a public high school, and the Supreme Court changed all that. But, you know, people were exposed to the Judeo-Christian ethic. Other end of the spectrum, a few years ago, half century later, taking the Spanish course, and if you're in the court here, your elementary basic stuff, you're learning about holidays, there were people in there who were, I guess, reasonably well-educated. They seemed to be. They seemed to be a less petty bourgeois type of thing. They hadn't a clue, you know, the celebration of the Epiphany in Spain. The three kings, the wise men, the magi, you know. And no. I mean, that is astounding. And you see these sort of surveys about where you've got 20% of the population now that is unchurched. That means what? They don't know what the Ten Commandments are. They don't know what the Golden Rule is, to say nothing of the Sermon on the Mount, you know. Man, that's a problem. So I don't know where that leads us in terms of giving people tools and giving them information. But I guess my point is, if you don't have some basic information, you know, it's tough. It's quite miraculous, actually. You know, it's one thing the apostles preaching to their fellow Jews. It's another thing with St. Paul talking to the Greeks. I don't know how he pulled that one off. You know, I really, you know, you've got no background. And so maybe miracles could happen in our day too.
So this is the thing, the fundamental, I see three fundamental illiteracies, I think you're absolutely right, among people across culture, particularly our students. I'm shocked sometimes. One, historical literacy, what you're describing. Second is theological literacy. And probably most dangerous is I see a complete ignorance or illiteracy of epistemology. People have not been taught at all anymore how to discern what they know and what they don't know, and how to think that through. And so all knowledge looks flat when that comes, whether it comes off of Twitter and Instagram or whether it comes out of the Bible. Although,
I mean, Greg, we're living in an emerging world where what's fake and what's real.
Exactly.
I mean, look at our last election cycle and all the, you know, people get a lot of more information through social media, and so it's not as cut and dry for younger generation as it was for us who are a bit older. We didn't have those distractions, but nowadays you can create things that seem real but are totally fake. So then it starts to cause you to question the foundation of, you know, what you know is real, which maybe brings us back full circle to say it's important to have some foundational knowledge as you step out into this social media world where there's all sorts of fake stuff that's out there that's purported to be real.
Which means those three intersect with each other.
Yeah, and Greg, I'd say layered on top of that, I think very important is a contemporary lack of the recognition of morality as a reality and other than just an opinion.
Right, and then the question is, where did you come from? A Catholic university, but that's probably handled differently than here.
Yeah, there's so much interesting things. I'm trying to think and put a kind of a common theme on this. I'm wondering whether, because part of the challenge too is, I think younger people in the society doesn't like to engage in argument or truth. Other things drive them, feelings, and I think beauty, I think the transcendent of beauty is an important one. So I'm thinking, how do we deal with this desert, if you will? And I think that issue that Dave mentioned, it's personal happiness and fulfillment and internal peace is something everyone can get. Because we know all this stuff doesn't make people happy. We know that. So maybe if we can enter through, you know, what makes you happier? What is your, you know, why are you here? What's your goal here? And we start with that ultimate question. Because if someone is willing to ask that ultimate question, and they're intellectually honest, or they're driven enough to figure it out, they will get to God.
What's your goal here?
We know. So that's where I'm thinking we have to start.
Let's find out. What's your goal here? Student, what's your goal here? What's your goal? Not here today, but your goal in life. What's your goal?
Hopefully to serve God.
What's that?
Hopefully to serve God.
To serve God. Okay.
Okay, that's pretty far along for a, we were 20?
But she's Catholic. I don't know whether when she went to, they still say, well, why are you here?
Yeah.
The road answer is to no longer serve God in this world.
She's been trained in that, which is your point. Luke, why, what's your goal?
The Westminster Confession says that the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. And that's...
But how many students, if we did the 4,200 that are here at Starman, could answer that same question? I mean, a lot of them would tell me, I want to be happy. That's the one I would hear if students come to my office.
Well, I would suggest that they also want to be successful. And I think that coming back to, so how do we engage students and get them, you know, thinking about these things? You have to take a look at what's going to motivate a student to even ask these questions. So I think part of it is motivation and part of it's tools, coming back to your tools question. I think creating opportunities to engage with the question of what gives meaning to life, what is happiness, thinking philosophically about truth. We've already replaced truth with relativism, so how do you get people back to critical thinking? I saw a professor write something in an article just recently published in the Valley News. I don't believe in evolution. He's an evolutionist, but he doesn't believe in evolution. He accepts evolution. So even the meaning of words is starting to change, and you have to get back to sort of the fundamentals. So I think part of it as Christians, we need to think, how do we even engage? How do we get the questions even started? Because a lot of people have left the questions behind, and they're engaged almost exclusively in real-time connectedness or information and things. But contemplation is quickly disappearing, I think.
So I'm wondering if we have to do it. The personal relationship element is even more important. And so what I find is, in my deal with mostly my friends and a lot of whom with people with whom I deal are more secular. They might believe in God in some shape or form, but it's distant. And what I'm finding is the greatest evangelical tool is a lived, joyful life. And it's kind of like, and that seems so more and more out of place today when there's just... such despair, and I get this, so I want what you have. Why are you so happy? And I think, you know, I guess then it's down to how can we need to be more authentic ourselves. We have to show, we need to show as Irenaeus, St. Irenaeus, we need to show the glory of God through a very flourishing, joyful life.
I'm a physician at Dartmouth, and I teach at the medical school, and I have a privilege of working with one of the courses called On Doctoring, which means that I work with students, a small group, 8 to 10 students for 2 years, and I work with them every week. And I think this is just one example, and I think there are many that are opportunities. We have many opportunities in an educational setting. I'm here for that reason, but also because I'm a parent, and I think about how to, our own children and helping them to think about these choices and balancing these things. But in this particular situation, in our small groups, we really get to know the students. And I will say that in my small group, for example, now I know them well enough to know what their religious background is, and I know that none of them one would consider himself a Christian, and the others would not. But we have discussions about value and about their own personal development, and they know, without it having anything to do with spirituality, that I'm committed to their growth and their development and their journey to become a physician and to become a balanced physician and to consider all aspects of their life and their wellness and how to do that. And part of that, I earn the opportunity to share with them how important it is to be thinking about things like their spirituality and what they believe in, whatever that is. But I have to kind of work around it. I can't give them facts. I can't say you must believe this or this is what... But what I can do is give them some of those, the opportunity to consider the value and the necessity of self-reflection and finding what really matters to them. I do find, though, that once I've done that and I build these relationships and we have them in our home and show them that we live a very joyful life and they ultimately find out that I'm a Christian, that they get it. They see something. And then I often have one-on-one conversations and have the opportunity to share what I believe, without saying, and so these things happen, but they happen often in small group settings. It's about building a relationship, and it's about one tool that we use, which is very practical in any setting, is the concept of motivational interviewing, which many of you probably know about. It's one concept, but it's how to get a patient, for example, to a better state of health. whether it's smoking, obesity, whatever it is, you start with trying to understand what they value. What do they like about it? What don't they like about it? What is their understanding of what it is? And what keeps them from moving down that, what are the obstacles to moving down that continuum to health? And then, because if you don't know what they believe and how they feel about it, you cannot give them advice. Once I understand that, then I can give them information, and then they can absorb it and I can work with that. But I have to start by understanding and doing some sort of, even with my students, and when I'm thinking about wanting to share my faith, I've got to start back at step one and do this motivational interviewing process to help move them down the continuum to considering their faith.
I have a question if I can raise. It's a little bit related to our topic and what Dave Evans mentioned, and this whole idea of creating life, you're creating value in your life. And one thing that I haven't heard spoken to a lot, and it's something I've seen more and more in the Dartmouth literature and more broadly amongst kind of high achievement organizations in our society, and that is this idea of changing the world. Dartmouth's motto now, and I even see it on my coffee cup, and it's like, we're here to change the world. We're educating students to change the world. And I think that has almost become a greater pressure than the money thing. And this idea that if you're not out there changing the world, you're a failure. And the expectations on that are so great. And I think, as I said before, Dave mentioned, that is a recipe for unhappiness.
I went to the wrong panel. You should have been over at GM. The title that you missed, you probably see on your program, it's, you know, we all love mankind, it's just people we hate.
Yeah. Well, and it's even more personal than that in terms of this idea of what's successful or value. So, you know, what I think that devalues so much, and I'll say it coming from here, a mother and father who have raised beautiful children, and on the surface, that mother or father, let's assume a mother, hasn't gone out and, you know, saved children in Africa, or that, you know, you have a handicapped child, or you are, you know, spending your time helping your aging parents, or, you know, different things like that. Those are really important, and those are so devalued in our society because you're not changing the world. And so I think for me that's an important issue.
I'm wondering if I can get you to answer your own question by talking about something a little bit more. Recently I was talking to a friend about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, and how I think the culture right now is concerned about life, liberty, and the pursuit of greatness. Greatness in changing the world, an extremely good education, a fantastic career, high profile job, etc. I'm wondering, do you think, and I'm at a Christian, at a Catholic university, I don't want to misquote this, but the personal prelature, or the doctrine of the Opus Dei, the sacredness of everyday life, do you think that's something that that people accepted more or had an openness to, that maybe there we would be more responsive as young people or as the people today about, well, I'm open to what the truth really is because I don't differentiate or create a hierarchy of, well, I'm not gonna go to that school because, you know, it's not an Ivy League. I'm gonna take that because it's less than six figures, and I'm gonna do this. Do you think there's just a general lack of understanding in our day to day that everything is sacred if it's, you know, purpose towards serving God?
Yeah, and I agree. There's a platonic kind of dualism that's going on, and we've had that through the history of mankind, kind of this Gnostic idea. Well, and I'm not objective. I think the Catholic faith, good Catholic thinkers have dealt with this very well. You know, if anyone's interested, one of the greatest, an encyclical that had a big impact on me, John Paul II wrote it on Laborum Exercens, I'm pronouncing it wrong, it's on labor, on the philosophy or theology, I should say, of work. And to your point, is that idea where human work, we are made to work to a degree, and that's where we can flourish through our work. And this idea, there's two components of work, an objective achievement, utilitarian component, and a subjective that makes us come alive, and we live out God, if you will, through our work. and it puts, it goes very counter to your reference to the hierarchy of value. This is higher value, lower, lower, lower. And again, I find sometimes I'm embarrassed to say, because it's easy for me to say, I've been, God's given me so much, and has given me some talent. So in the worldly terms, I look very successful. So it's like, who's she to say this? But like, every work is valuable. And from the person who cleans the office to the trash collector to that, and it's, you know, our society, that goes counter to a lot of thinking. But you, in order for you to really internalize that, you have to believe there's something beyond you. It's. I almost think you have to have a transcendent sense that there is a God or something beyond our human world for you to really encapsulate that.
I think that's huge. I think the absence of transcendence leaves it all to personal opinion in terms of what's important. If you don't have a standard of what meaningfulness is and what true value is, then it's left to Darwinian systems to figure out what's superior and what's inferior. I think your point is it's huge that you have to see your life as having some sort of transcendent meaning, not just what you define your life to have meaning, how it's going to have meaning. In the absence of that, it's just competition. Competition determines what's valued. And that, so transcendence is huge, and I think it's completely missing from a lot of the dialogue.
I think there's an interesting phenomenon going on right now that many of you probably heard about, and it's this issue of virtual signaling. Have you heard much about this? Marketing and branding world's huge. We just saw this a couple of weeks ago with the whole Pepsi commercial. We live in this culture now where we're trying to reflect what do I think this person wants me to be? And so we ask this question, you know, what is the whole idea of impact in the world? The young generation wants to make an impact. We're already placing some kind of pressure that's not necessarily built on their internal design, but what they think they want us to hear, so to speak. So this virtual signaling is going on, saying, okay, I'm going to tell you what the core virtue of what I think you want to hear from me. But it's not necessarily inherent to the transcendent elements that we're talking about, or for that matter, eternal, for those of us that believe in that kind of purpose. So we're creating these falsehoods right now. And I would imagine, Luann, you're going to tell us about some of those tools that get to the core of the individual, so we have a centered set approach rather than a bounded model of just information without any thought or epistemology, Greg, like you talked about.
So I think Greg and I have had discussions about this panel before. We may differ not in opinion but in emphasis perhaps on this, because for me, and I guess so since it worked for me, I think it has to work for everyone. For me, it took a lot of time on my knees. It took a lot of time in quiet reflection and prayer. And I remember talking in January to students about this. It's like, we're so over scheduled. And I think probably folks in our milieu are achievement orientation, we need to think more about being on that mountain probably than others. And this idea that quiet reflection alone and prayer alone with God is what can get you there. I mean, it's easy. You can understand something intellectually in your head, but to bring it to your heart, to really have it integrated and you really believe it in yourselves, I just think takes prayer, takes time alone. I'm a big believer in, you know, doing where you can, doing less, because most of us err on doing too much.
One practical thing on that, with like my students again, who are not in this realm of talking about their faith, but just the reflection piece, I always, you know, when we're talking about a panel that they just heard on somebody dying and them dealing with the loss of a child and they had to do, it's emotional, it's tough. Just getting them to write and reflect, period, in a world where they are so driven by memorizing facts and details and all of that, just getting a student to stop and reflect on anything is important, and a tool that's very easy, even if you don't have the opportunity to get them to reflect specifically or call it prayer, just even introducing reflection or writing journaling so that it can begin to think and stop, you know, the beginning.
On that, I just read an article recently. This is the enemy of reflection. Apparently. I mean, this is, kids just don't walk down the street anymore whistling a happy tune and looking at the trees and the birds. I mean, they've got this thing and they're, you know, who's sending them some message?
It's a tool of self-reflection.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm interested in this term, the hierarchy of value. How do you think about it? A hierarchy of value means that something is better or higher than something else. In other words, it's a trumping type of function. I think sometimes like Maslow's triangle, if you remember Maslow's triangle, there's a hierarchy of value. His insight was it's contextual. There's certain things trump others depending on what the circumstances are. If you're hungry, the bottom of the pyramid matters. But there's also kind of a spiritual hierarchy of value, if you will. And you're kind of talking around the edge of that. There's a lot of life experience in this room, and we're also talking about how we impart that to the young. How do you think of that in terms of trying to get that across to people for whom the world looks very flat right now? Everything's all the same, and we, you know, can't pass any judgment on somebody else's hierarchy, but some things have to be more important than others, I think. But I'm not even sure of that. But let's first talk about hierarchy of value, and I want to come back to, is there really a hierarchy? What do you think? Hierarchy of values. Do you have one? Do you have one? Well, I'm talking to you. Yeah, a hierarchy of value.
I think personal, what you're getting at is there's a secular hierarchy of value that places judgment on other people.
I think there's certainly that contrast, right? And then there's also an eternal one that people have. But what do you think about that? Is there a hierarchy of value? Is there? You use the term.
Well, God is number one for, I think, me and many of us in the world. So it all flows, it's vertical. It's number one. And then it flows from there. So the people around you, your nearest relations, and then it flows from there. I think, you know, in terms of maybe as it relates to our more, you know, the environments we live in, it plays itself out in our interactions with people. And that gets, you know, one of the things that I found frustrating, I didn't really understand it until afterwards reflecting back, and that was the utilitarianism of the work environment, and you certainly saw that on Wall Street to a great degree. People are used as cogs, and I think it's becoming more and more so. And that's tough. I mean, I don't know the answer to all this, and I think it's one of the reasons Pope Francis has been so popular, if you will, because he might not always have the best language around it, but he clearly represents a counter to, we're not just cogs in an economic wheel. And so I guess to me it's just that God, and then through God, the human, because God is in each of us. We are all walking vessels of God. And so that, without a doubt, is number one.
There's two like basic stances. That's one. And the other is Ecclesiastes. Still coming back to that, you know, the premise of Ecclesiastes is under the sun in this world. And Ecclesiastes starts with the premise, I'm going to look at this world and see what I can find. You can't ever forget that as you read that book. And what's the word that keeps coming back that he quoted as vanity, it's meaningless. It's the Hebrew word is, it's a breath exhale. It has a substance for a second, but then it's gone. And so the Ecclesiastes view is everything under the sun, there is no hierarchy of value. The hierarchy of value is always zero. It all ends up worthless, even though it appears to have value.
You've limited your framework.
Sorry?
But you've limited your framework.
Exactly.
But your framework is eternal, one of eternity.
Right.
That our consciousness in this world isn't the end. And you know, I believe in heaven, and I have some perspectives on what heaven is for me and what that will be in coming. And I believe in eternity. I feel it in my soul. But I recognize the fact that my body is finite. This world is definitely finite. I often think of myself as a cow in a field, as I understand eternity at times. You know, but that's by design.
Yeah.
From a good God. So I accept Ecclesiastes, what it says, it's all sort of folly in a sense under the sun, but to me that puts a bracket on eternity that I don't accept, that I don't live for that finiteness. I live for something beyond that, but I have to live in the context of here.
Dave Ellis rightly said Ecclesiastes is written circular. I think one of the profound subverses in the Bible is 3:11b. God has set eternity in the hearts of men, but they cannot fathom it out. And then he goes right back to, well, let's look under the sun and see what we see. And so we're kind of trapped in this world. And this is how do you bring young people into this view when they're getting a very different framing, which is this world where you look for your information and your value.
I think you have to answer that to some degree.
Okay.
I own a boutique wellness company. I work with people of all ages. And the people who do the best are the people who are in a good relationship and have spirituality in their lives. Very, very practically and measured, they always do the best. I'm wondering about, maybe there's nothing that we can do other than show the good example that you talked about, kind of a great life because I'm a spiritual person, and then be there for the young people as they go through everything they go through up until the point that it seems always to be the case with my clients that they have to recognize that they're doomed without a higher power and a spirituality in their life. And that doom can take various shapes. It could be emotional, it could be financial, something that is impossible without a higher power to overcome. And then just to make sure that I'm there when that occurs. I'm not sure that, my view anyway, there's a God's plan for everybody's life, and I can't accelerate it or decelerate it. I'm not that powerful, but I can be an agent. But
I'm not sure the evidence actually bears that out. I think when you look at the world and the culture that we live in, it seems like people with questionable morals and questionable values sometimes are the ones that are the wealthiest and the most powerful. And yet I think I work in war affected communities with children and women and children in those places, and I get my inspiration from the suffering church, from people that have overcome insurmountable odds and still found God to be faithful in those circumstances. And I think what I fear in the culture that we live is the whole wealth and prosperity doctrine sort of owns the day sometimes, and that isn't meaningful at the end of it all. You know, and if that's what gets positioned as that's what draws young people in, I think it's a false premise.
Absolutely agree with that. I think the gentleman who asked the sacrifice. Sacrifice is so important, and it is so devalued, especially I think amongst developed countries, because we think we can control everything.
Yeah.
And when we can control, you got sick, oh, you smoked, that's why you got lung cancer. Oh, you got run over, and you weren't wearing your seatbelts. Like, everything is controlled, and so there's not this, and I think that's one thing where not to romanticize people and develop, you know, people that are very impoverished or war-torn situations, but that sense of gratitude, as we spoke, and that sense that, no, I might be in this difficult stance, not because of something I did, but it's beyond me, and that it's not something that I brought to myself. You might even do it subjectively. I think a lot of us do that.
One of the things I try to teach my kids is there's no justice. Don't look at this. Don't look for justice in this world. In 2004, to your point about, you know, the wicked prosper. 2004 was just post-Enron, so we all had to teach ethics in our classes at Tufts. Everybody had to work this into a class. So I decided to come in here as entrepreneurship. I decided to teach ethics when nobody's looking, because nobody watches, nobody regulates startups. You know, they can do whatever they want. So I wanted to get my entrepreneurial students thinking about what's ethics. So I led it with a paper by Howard Stevenson, who invented entrepreneurship education at Harvard, and the title of it was, Why Be Honest When Honesty Doesn't Pay? And he demolishes the concept that being honest will get you ahead in business, with just case after case of the guys who won were the dishonest ones. You know, and this is as old as the Bible. I mean,
ecclesiastic rails on it. Psalm 73, if you haven't read Psalm 73, read that tonight. You live in that world every day. My feet almost slipped when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Right? So we talked about that. And what was interesting in that class, as we taught it, or as we had it, we thought it was a discussion, was the degree to which the more I pressed them on, you know what goes around doesn't come around. You know what? Nobody's going to stop you from being dishonest, and that's the way to win. The more they got their back up and said, wait, no. And they said, no, the honest people win in the end. And I said, no, there's no justice. Look around you. And the more I said that, the more they rebelled at that notion. And at the end, and I just asked them to step back and think about, why was that so offensive to them as an idea? When it actually defies the evidence of your senses, why do you believe that? And it forced a lot of people to start looking at exactly what Dave talked about, which is what we see versus what we want to see. Okay. Yeah.
Greg, to a point you made kind of right in the beginning about how you're perplexed at the paradox that people were willing to embrace and not fully engage with. And I think one of the things that we want our young people to understand and think about is, does it matter what they believe? Does it matter if you believe in false things? Is there some moral standard that you should embrace? What does success and happiness really mean? Because if there's not great consequence to what you believe, then you're willing to drift along, I think. But to the point that this fellow made a little bit earlier, if your benchmark is eternity, not just tomorrow, you start thinking about things in a very profound way. If there's a day of judgment or there isn't, you think about things in a very profound way. So I think trying to have people understand and think a little bit more about the consequences of what they believe may lead them to want to engage with thinking about what they believe.
What was interesting was these students clearly thought that what they believed was different once they were confronted with it, what they really believed. And it really stopped, you know, when people went away really thinking about it. So, I'm just interested, and you got to actually vote so I can get a real sample here. How many of you are happy? How many of you are not happy? I'm not happy. I am angry. Every day I look at the world, I think, this is not right, you know? I'm extremely happy. The interesting thing when I ask my students this, you know, that I ask them what is their goal, I often would come in, especially this time of year they start coming, because they got to go get jobs, and they're suddenly realizing, you know, the world's confronting me, what am I going to do? And they ask, what should I do? You know, because they've only thought about a couple of things like consulting and iBanking, because that's what everybody else is doing. And then they realize, well, I'm not sure I want to do that. And one of the things we start with is, so what do you really want? And they say, well, I want to be happy. I said, happiness is overrated. I said, if you get happy, you're just going to then be looking for what's the next thing. You know, what are you really looking for? But the question that was always the stumper is I say, okay, close your eyes for a minute. I want you to pretend it's 25, 30 years from now. Pick a number. And you come back to see me. I'm this doddering old professor. But you come back to tell me how it worked out. What was the story? Tell me what you see. Because that's what they're asking me, is where I want to go. And they were asking me, of course, the question of where do I start? And I asked the question, where do you want to end up? And they'll always stop it. They'll say, I'm doing this in my job. I said, I didn't ask you about your job. You can tell me that if you want, but I asked you what your life looked like. And they step back and they think, that's a really good question. I don't know. And I said, well, don't you want to think about that? I said, well, yeah. They didn't even know how to think about that question. And that's really the question that we've been talking about in this session, right?
Yeah, but it's really interesting, Greg, because I've not necessarily thought about it in so much those terms. I think the eternity issue is without a doubt, that's the end of the road. So your whole life should be focused on eternity.
Beginning.
The end. The eternity. But
what do you want your
life to look like in 10 or 20 or 25 years? That for me is you're assuming too much in your control, and so I've always thought and guided people, God's given you talents, so you've got to figure out what is it, your God-given talents. Know thyself is so critical, and then with that, usually He throws things in your path as you go on. So I never think beyond 1 or 2 years, frankly. I literally never thought beyond 1 or 2 years. And that's freed me up to kind of do this winding path, because I wasn't like, nah, I can't go to that lecture, or I can't, entertain that, that meeting with someone that turns into a job, because I've got this 20-year plan. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to push that.
You chopped that vanilla.
Greg, I appreciate the value of your question, because it forces your students to try and discern what was valuable to them,
yeah,
which is wonderful. As you were saying it, and I love your response to it, I was wondering myself, I wonder, would it be possible to poll, especially the older members of this group, as to whether they think it's a good question? Because when I talk to young people, when I talk to my kids, and I talk about the things that were most important directionally to where I've become, it's the things I did not want. It's the bad things that happened to me that I resisted.
That's not what we were talking about, though.
Exactly. So my plan and God's plan, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plan. So the older members of this audience, I'd love to hear sort of their perspective, because they're wiser than us.
Well, Greg, I have a question for you. You told us about the beginning of your career and how that your plan was to go out and make a bunch of money so you could have a farm here in New Hampshire.
And retire early.
And here you are. And I'm going to guess that if you were to describe heaven for Greg, that there'd be elements of that that are consistent with that vision you had. And all you have done is exercise or orchestrate your life in a way to get to that place.
Yeah.
And that your farm in New Hampshire is, in a sense, a manifestation of what heaven is like for Greg Fairbrothers as you understand your journey through this world. And maybe a place to start to tell your students is to say, where's eternity for you? And what would that possibly look like? And go to that place. And as you go to that place or make that journey a reality, you'll discover your talents. You'll use them to turn your own light on and help others and become a beacon, in a sense.
No, not to psychoanalyze over psychoanalyze Greg, but
why not? Be your own case study.
Two interesting things about this. One is, at the time even that I was thinking about that, and it happened actually while I was still here, I wasn't really thinking about what I wanted and not choosing it. It was almost a recognition. I can still tell you where and when it happened. I just realized one day a light bulb went on. It was almost like a vision. It was a recognition. That's where I need to be. I need to go there. And I later told this when I was interviewing for a company I worked for. It turned out 20 years. I thought it would be about 2, because I didn't want to live in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And I was interviewing a very bright young entrepreneur who built a really big company eventually. And very successful, very ruthless guy. And I didn't want that job. And we're interviewing. And he said, so what's your long-term goal? And I said, I want to have a farm in Vermont. I want to be a millionaire at 30. I was 23 or 4 at the time. I said, I want to be a millionaire at 30 and retire at 35 to a farm in Vermont. And he goes, oh, okay. And I thought, well, there goes that job, And years later, we were in some event at the company, and he told everybody the story. I had forgotten this entirely. And he said, that's when I decided to hire him. So I went in and saw him about a week later. I said, Charles, so I don't get that. I was telling you, I didn't give a crap about your work or your job, and I was going to retire within 6 years and leave you after I'd made some money that you helped me make. Why was that appealing to you? And he said, because I've learned in hiring, working with people, that people who set a goal and have a plan to get there will always do well in life. And the people that don't, don't. And I said, well, it was a stupid goal, and I was telling you I was going to leave you. And he said, look, the leaving me, that was my job. If I couldn't keep you, then you should go. But people who do that in one thing usually do it everywhere. So notice, though, that the question I asked was not, what is your path to get there? Yet, and I didn't ask, what is your job or your career or your vocation even? I just had, tell me what your life looks like, which is really a way of saying, what's important enough to you that bubble to the top, which is the hierarchy of value. What did they value most? And the first revelation for almost all of them was, implicitly, I'm valuing my career the most, because that's the way I answered. And they called out, is that really what you mean? And a lot of them would say, well, no, I'm not so sure that's what I mean. So it was really a platform to drive the discussion and get them thinking about the start of the journey. And everything else in between you can't plan. In fact, that's in my entrepreneurship book. You get the long-term goal where you're a company to be, and you talk about the first couple of weeks. The rest of it,
you know, no plan survives first touch with the enemy. So you had a comment.
I was going to say just that, that I mean, I think with my students, I talk about both, I'm a both and person. You know, if you don't have those goals, if you don't think about where you want to go, then you won't be moving. On the other hand, I don't tell them about my perfect, wonderful grand life, because I let them know about the ups and the downs and all those things too. So they know very well. And I talk about that. You know, I look at things so differently at each stage of my life that my goals change. And like you said, things happen that I didn't expect and I had to respond. And that's all good. And you can anticipate that you're going to be a different person tomorrow than you are today. And you'll value things differently. And that's great. So you have to be fluid about the way you said as you get there. But you want to know and you want to respect your own values and identify them. And I want to do that for you as well. I want to understand what you really value, because you lose sight of that in this process. That being said, you want to value and hold them, but you also want to be fluid and let them change and grow as you change and have to respond to everything that comes. So I think the both and is important. It's not one or the other. Absolutely. You need to have that both.
Dan Gilbert wrote a book, Stumbling on Happiness. I mean, you read it. But the tagline in the book is, every day we're making decisions for a person we've never met. It's the person we're going to meet tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So, so happiness. Happiness is important to you? Now, not so many hands.
Well, I guess it depends on what you mean by happiness exactly. Do you mean happiness as in like the beginning, like, oh, like this, you know, this delicious chocolate, you know, mousse makes me happy, versus like joy, like more enduring, like no matter what I experience in my life, no matter what hardships I am, you know, I have to experience, like, am I still grounded in like joyful?
Right, not to get into nomenclature, but happiness and joy are very different things, right? At least we mean different things by it. Napoleon was asked in Mount Helena, at St. Helena, by a biographer, what was the ultimate secret of your battle plan? And he said, Austin Gaja at the local wall. One engages, then one sees. Mm-hmm. And I think that's probably the best advice for life, you know. But if you don't have a sense of who you want to be and what your values are, you have foundation from which to judge, respect that hierarchy of value. And we keep coming back to, Sarah said it today, we always make sure it gets written into the opening remarks. You may be thinking about what you want, but the real question is, what is God want?
You know, a hopeful note is the Laser Wheel Out Society and these kind of little Christian groups are sprouting everywhere on these kind of desert, very secular places. So I see, and doesn't get a lot of press, and we hear, you know, whatever, we hear the bad stuff that's happening, you know, speakers being beaten up at Middlebury or whatever. But there is a lot of really fruitful stuff happening, and so I sense young people are seeking. I think deep down, you know, our hearts are restless until they rest in me. I mean, we are made to love God because He loves us so much. And so I think my sense is I'm hopeful. I feel like we might be turning a corner.
What's around the corner?
That a resurgence. In America, we always have these resurgences of religious but my sense is that younger generation, and what's really interesting is, I do this exercise in one of my finance classes where they have to value a company, and ultimately based on the share price. And all the time, everyone does buys, always buy. Very few, you know, young people want to put a sell recommendation on a company. I just did it last week with this year's group, and they practically were all sells. You know, they were putting sell recommendations like Tesla. Oh, Tesla, it's a sell. It's, you know, just, and you talk to these kids and they're much more sober and kind of realistic. And I thought, you know, that might sound like a negative thing, but you know, I sense they have, that their feet are more grounded in some respects. And not everyone, but I don't know. I'm hopeful because I think people are seeking. You know, another one, he's Catholic Bishop Robert Barron, who has been hugely successful evangelizing because he's brilliant, but he can talk, he engages in popular culture. He's always talking about popular movies. And he is now one of the hottest things on the internet because he engages directly with a lot of agnostics and atheists really successfully. And so, I don't know, I think we need to be hopeful. And I think we just have to live, we have to imbue our people around, we have to imbue our environment with joy and peace, because ultimately I think that's what's going to attract people.
Faith, hope, and love. Well, we got about 7 minutes if you want to use it. Any other comment? It's kind of like a 7 minute warning. No? I mean, it's hard to top that. I thank you all for coming. Remember, many are asking who can show us any good, and I think the answer is you can. So hopefully you're doing that each day. We'd love to even hear more back. As you can tell, we're still looking for what can we be doing to do a better job in this environment, trying to just get people thinking, young people thinking and focusing on this stuff early, and trying to ask those questions at a time when they can actually do something about it. So thanks all of you for coming.